Our moon has had a great status from the beginning of human civilization. It was immortalized by various religions all around the world. In Greek mythology, there was a moon goddess named Selene, the daughter of the Titans Hyperion and Theia. It was worshipped and respected the same way as the sun god Helios, which indicates that our ancestors placed the moon and the sun on equal footing. The moon is also worshipped in Hindu mythology by those who have fluctuations in their life, ups and downs, and by those who wish to have sons. The moon is featured in Van Gogh's masterpiece, The Starry Night, Frank Sinatra's delightful song, Fly Me to the Moon, and many other captivating artworks. Art and history have always been enchanted by the moon, but today we intend to highlight the important role of the moon in elevating our civilization from a specific perspective. Our aim is to answer the question, what would happen if the moon disappeared? Before answering that question, here are some facts about the moon. Number 1. The moon is the nearest and brightest celestial object orbiting the Earth in an elliptical path. It may not follow the same path every cycle due to the fact that its orbit orientation is not entirely fixed in space, but rotates over time, resulting in precision and inclination. Its apparent size differs from the actual size due to the relative motion to an observer on the Earth. You can understand this as follows. The nearer an object to you, the bigger you will see it. Number 2. The moon was formed 4.51 billion years ago, approximately after 60 million years of the entire formation of the solar system. There are several models regarding the moon formation, but the prevailing model is that the Earth-Moon system was formed due to an extremely huge impact between a Mars-sized celestial body called Theia and the proto-Earth, which is the Earth at its very early stages. The impact resulted in the Earth with its shape today, and some other material in its orbit which accreted and formed the moon. Number 3. Like the Earth, the moon is a differentiated celestial body that can be divided into crust, mantle, and core. The core is solid with a molten iron boundary around it. The mantle is the largest layer formed by a complex yet extremely important process called the magma fractional crystallization. The geochemical mapping of the moon rocks collected by the Apollo mission suggests that the crust is mainly composed of mafic minerals, which are rich in magnesium and iron. The photo decomposition process prevents the formation of water on the lunar surface. In other words, the photons radiated by the sun decompose the water molecules formed on the lunar surface. After knowing some interesting facts about the moon and how it was formed, it's time to consider the main question of today's episode. Number 1. You may wonder what is exactly the relation between the moonlight absence and the disturbance of the ecosystem, because at the first glance, they may seem completely unrelated. However, they are strongly connected. The ecosystem is by definition a biological community of interacting organisms and their physical environment. It contains biotic and abiotic parts. The biotic parts include all the living organisms, whereas the abiotic compounds include the environmental factors such as rocks, temperature, and humidity. According to the Encyclopedia of National Geographic, every factor in the ecosystem depends on every other factor, either directly or indirectly, and the slight disturbance in one factor will end up affecting the whole ecosystem. For example, the change in temperature of an ecosystem will limit the type of plants that grow in there, and hence will affect the animals that depend on these plants as a primary source of food and shelter, leading them to adapt to that change or move to another ecosystem or perish. Another important and related concept to highlight is the food chain, which describes how energy and nutrients move through an ecosystem. In the food chain, energy is transferred from one living organism through another in the form of food. There are primary producers such as plants, primary consumers such as animals that depend on plants as their food source, and secondary consumers such as predators and decomposing organisms. The moonlight is considered an extremely important factor in the ecosystem. According to a study published in the Journal of Animal Ecology, the absence of moonlight will suppress the activity of prey species that use vision as their primary sensory system, and increase the activities of those who use other sensory systems, such as olfaction or echolocation. Think of it as follows. The predators that use vision, such as lions and owls, will not be able to hunt during the night in the absence of moonlight. However, the olfactory predators who are attracted to scent, such as foxes, cats, and snakes, will still be able to hunt. This disturbance in the food chain will eventually lead to an irreparable loss of the ecosystem balance. Number 2. Tides are waves with extremely low frequency, hence with very long periods, that move across the oceans as a response to the gravitational pull exerted on the Earth by the Sun and the Moon. The gravitational pull generates some force that's called the tidal force, which in turn makes the ocean's water to bulge outward, creating points with low and high tides. The Sun has the same tidal effect on the Earth's water as the Moon does. However, the total tidal force generated by the Sun's gravitational pull is about half of the lunar tidal force, and that's because the Sun is further away from the Earth. And as we have mentioned before, the Moon is the nearest celestial body to the Earth. Therefore, the tidal force exerted by the Moon is the primary cause of ocean tides. But it's important to be aware of the fact that the Sun can enhance or detract from the Moon's tidal effects. That's because the Sun and the Moon do become in alignment with the Earth at some points when the Moon is full or new. And as a result of this alignment, the whole Sun's tidal force is added to the Moon's tidal force, making the high tides very high and the low tides very low. These tides are called the spring tides, and they occur twice a month. For the first and third quarter phases of the Moon, the Sun and the Moon are not in line with each other, making the Sun's tidal force retracted from the Moon's tidal force. Therefore, the tidal effect is less in these quarters, and again, the high tides will be less higher and the low tides will be lower. These tides are called neap tides. To recap, the Moon's gravitational pull and the rotational force of the Earth are the main causes of high and low tides. The gravitational pull of the Moon makes the water on the nearest side to bulge out as a high tide, but the rotational force of the Earth on the other side is greater than the Moon's gravitational pull, making the water to pile up as it resists the pull of gravity in a form of a high tide too. There are low tides everywhere. The area connecting the low and high tides is called the intertidal zone. That area is alternately covered and uncovered by the ocean's water throughout the entire day. There are microorganisms that live in the intertidal zone. They also depend on the tidal currents to move across the oceans. The entire ocean's ecosystem depends to a great extent on these microorganisms as a primary source of food. Now imagine the oceans without tides due to the absence of the Moon's gravitational pull. There will be a great disturbance of the ocean's ecosystem due to the food chain damage, leading the entire marine life to perish eventually. Number 3. Ocean tides are considered a great source of power in the regions with extreme tidal variations, such as the River Rance in France and Nova Scotia in Canada, where they've already built power plants that harness tides as a source of energy. Without the Moon, there would be no gravitational pull to generate these tides, and they would no longer be a promising source of renewable energy. Number 4. Earth's atmosphere is subject to the same tidal forces as the ocean's water. These fluctuations in the atmosphere are called the atmospheric tides, which contributes to the upper and lower flow of the temperature through the atmosphere, and this makes some regions' climate dependent upon the Moon's position in its phases relative to the Earth. The Moon absence will be considered as a climate-changing factor in these regions, pretty much as the greenhouse effect. Number 5. The ocean tides themselves are considered to be weather-changing factors, since the ocean is considered to be a heat reservoir, that is. The heat intake is constant. The only constantly changing factors are the tidal currents, and they help distribute the temperature across the oceans. In other words, tides affect the movement of ocean currents, which in turn affect the weather by the amount of temperature carried by the moving water through a given area. according to a paper published in the Journal of Royal Astronomical Society of Canada, and named the moon and the weather, gales of wind are remarkably prevalent in Torres Straits and the neighborhood about the time of new and full moon. This was noted by Dr. Rattray, a surgeon in the Navy, in connection with observations made by the surveying ship Fly during the 3 years, 1841 to 44. Dr. Rattray noticed that at those times there was a large area of coral reef uncovered at the very low water of the spring tides, extending out some 60 to 70 miles from the land. This large area becomes heated, and the great heating of that large portion of land gives rise to gales at the full and change, that is, at the new and full moon. Number 6. One of the most important effects of the moon is that it helps stabilize the rotation of Earth. When Earth rotates, it goes backward and forward as it spins, with some variations in its axial tilt. The Earth axial tilt is 23.4 degrees, but it fluctuates between 22.1 degrees to 24.5 degrees over a 41,000-year period. These axial fluctuations would vary drastically without the moon. As a result, the Earth would wobble much more and eventually leading to potentially strong climactic effects. You may understand that as follows. Without the moon as a tilt stabilizer, the Earth tilt would reach 90 degrees. That is, the equator would replace the north and south poles. Imagine Africa being covered in ice at some intervals. This would result in far more extreme variations between temperatures and daylight throughout the year. At other times, the Earth's axis would be straight up and down, making night and day equally long, and there would be no seasons. They would just be long periods of extreme weather and huge differences between winter and summer. According to Kari Aksnes, a theoretical astrophysicist, a good example of this is Mars, which has no large moon to stabilize it, so it tilts more. The Martian climate and atmosphere have undergone enormous changes in the past millions of years. We probably would see something similar to that here. In conclusion, without the moon, there would be one-third of the ocean tides due to the sun's gravitational pull, and as a result, the marine life would be severely disrupted. There would be shorter days due to the lack of the tidal friction, which allows the rotation of Earth. There would be a huge impact on the weather and the general climates on Earth. Not to mention that we would be more vulnerable to a shower of asteroids that was soaked up by the moon every day, threatening numerous species due to the impact of collisions. Without the moon, we probably would not evolve to the same level as today, or even survive.